What's on your mind, sir?
Those are the things that are on my mind. Things about a medium that has come into maturity and it has radically changed over the course of my 40 or so years involved in it. Today is August 12th. Happens to be my dead sister's birthday. Been dead for many years, wonderful sister. And it is the year 2010. I'm sitting in my office at the School of Visual Arts, MFA Photography and Related Media Program, of which I am the chair and have been involved with this school for 25 years and have been the chair, I think, since 1988. Seems like a long time that just sped by so quickly. I am doing an interview with David for the purpose of recording some thoughts, ideas, and perhaps facts, if one ever knows facts, because history is always in the mind of that person which records that history, and that doesn't mean that's a definitive history. But nevertheless, I have some views that I think have not been recorded and perhaps will have some meaning for somebody in the future that are relevant to my career and relevant to my experience as I've worn any number of different hats in this medium of photography. I've been an administrator. I am always a photographer first. I've done many different kinds of photography, though basically I conceive of myself as a fine artist or an artist photographer. I don't know what fine art is anymore. I have been involved in the gallery world and I have been an educator throughout my entire career. I want to go back to the obvious place, which is the beginning of my interest in photography, and just have that chronicled for the record, or at least for somebody's edification, that this is how I perceived my life and my beginnings in this medium. I was born in Louisville, Kentucky, to a professional class family. My mother was a social worker, my father was a doctor in internal medicine, a diabetic specialist. He had come from a small town in Illinois called Lincoln, Illinois, which was dead smack in the center of that state, a flat, fairly uninteresting prairie town, which was also the home, and he was a childhood friend of William Maxwell, the famous writer and editor of The New Yorker. That said, I'll get back to it. My mother was from Louisville, and she had met my father at the University of Illinois in the 20s, where she went to school and he went to school. I subsequently went to school there, as did my brother, as did my aunt, my uncle, and my first cousin. In Louisville, I grew up in a rather, in retrospect, that one never understands those things at the time, idyllic environment, a kind of residential neighborhood smack in the middle of the city, middle to upper middle class, bordered by a Frederick Law Olmsted park called Cherokee Park, one of the most beautiful parks in America. We lived in a house, an Ossie and Harriet kind of house, neighborhood, nice boys and nice girls and generally professional and such people. We could take the bus downtown to downtown Louisville, we could run in the park, we could bicycle to school, and our life was relatively safe and hermetic. Louisville was an interesting town in that it had a southern culture on the border of the Midwest and oriented itself business-wise really to the east. It was relatively unspoiled in terms of its architecture and its histories of its edifices, though by the 60s urban renewal took out a good deal of the downtown, which was once quite wonderful. Though even today it's still reasonably well preserved. It has always been a comfortable town, a very ethnocentric town, and a town one could really say is a pretty ideal place to grow up. It wasn't as bigoted as people might have thought or seen in you know, as get stereotyped in certain southern towns. Public schools were desegregated in 1954, for and was a model for Brown versus Board of Education. We had good theater, good orchestra, and a good deal of culture there, even though it was a conservative city. In those days it was Democratic, today it's very Republican. I'm giving you that background because that's the background of my upbringing. I went to public schools. My mother went to the basic same schools I went to. My brother and sister went to those schools. We were Jewish. In a city where there weren't too many Jews, though there were 5,000 or so, there were actually two Reformed synagogues, maybe two conservative, and at least one or two Orthodox, believe it or not. Everybody knew everybody. My mother's family had been in that city for generations, really back to the 1840s, and were part of the founding of a synagogue there. My father's family had been in central Illinois for several generations as well, though his father came from Germany. My father also spoke German as a young man. Having grown up in that wonderful idyllic way, or more or less, I guess I'm using that term a little too loosely, though I think in retrospect to times now and to things that and the privileges of people, I would have to say I grew up in a pretty privileged way. Though, like everybody has their cross to bear, so to speak, I was the third child, the youngest, born right after the war, 1945. Father had just come back from serving in the war as a medical person. He was the kind of doctor who did his rounds every night. He worked very hard. He drove to patients' houses every day, blah, 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 blah. I was the third child and learning disabled, though they didn't know that those days. They didn't have a term for those things. While I was somewhat precocious, I also had I did not learn to read until I was at least almost in the fourth grade. I didn't speak early, had to be tutored all through the early parts of grade school phonetically in order to learn to read. I was sent home from school, I think, in one of the early grades, second grade maybe, and they told my parents I was retarded. My father, being who he was, knew a little better. However, that handicap did stay with me, and as I said, in those days no one knew about learning disabilities and all those things, but I was clearly learning disabled. And I had an uncle who was probably also so, who never really developed very much. I always couldn't understand why I couldn't get the plug-in right. That is, you know, I knew, thought I was smart, thought I was wise, could see the big picture, but never understood why I couldn't get the details, why I was so slow at math, so slow at reading, all the things that held me back. I was never a great student. I didn't have a lot of concentration. I still don't have a lot of concentration today. But that said, I could I could weld things together pretty well. And my personality overwhelmed probably the handicaps. My father, and here we're getting to the real story, had a Boise camera, what was called a Boise 35 millimeter camera. And then when I was very young, I think he had it in the Army, either he bought it right after the Army. Then he bought a Leica 3F. Probably in the early 50s, 53, 54. He used it for some medical reasons, but basically he used it as a hobbyist. And he did subsequently build a little darkroom down in the basement. Didn't have running water, but he developed pictures. And we frequently got the popular photography, modern photography magazines, which I looked at, usually at the naked pictures or the nude pictures. This was a book we had in our household called Modern American Painting. It was the Whitney Museum. This is the book we have. Series of Contemporary American Artists. Maybe it isn't the Whitney Museum. But the pictures, of course, that I remember very well are pictures like this, but Henry Billings, I remember this sort of very sensual kind of thing called The Arrest. But I want to find a couple of more that'll... There's a Paul Cadmus in here somewhere, on the woman on the beach with her breast exposed was one of my favorite. This famous picture called High Yellow by Reginald Marsh. This book, even now, this was the first probably prurient thing I looked at. Persephone by Thomas Hart Benton. And this is still, I think, a reasonably well-known book of its kind. There's just many pictures in here that resonate with me from my childhood. Also, we had a Harper's Illustrated History of the Civil War, a number of illustrated books that I remember very clearly looking at as a child. I remember also getting early comic books, particularly Bugs Bunny, but my brother got Dick Tracy, I think, and he got something else. He was 4 years older, but I couldn't read the comics. I only looked at the pictures. When I think about this book and all those early 20th century American painters, I see that work reflected in my own photographs, from the nudes that I've done, to the street pictures and portraits, to the kind of candid pictures I've made. So to answer the question, did I think in pictures? I don't know if I was thinking of pictures, but I sure was looking at them, and they held strongly in my mind, perhaps stronger than those things. Perhaps I was developing a visual literacy without even knowing it to a higher degree than I might have been developing my literary skills. We did have, not a great number, but a number of books that related to American art in the household. This was one, Modern American Painting. We also had one in which I thought this was it, but it isn't, that chronicled the collection of the Whitney Museum. In that particular book, there was a picture by Cadmus of Coney Island Beach with a woman exposed with her breasts showing. It was an important picture because my own beach pictures, I think, relate to that picture, but also to Reginald Marsh, to Billings, Thomas Hart Benton, to any number of American artists of that period, of that descriptive, the Ashcan School, but also to that descriptive kind of street New York imagery of that period. There was a guy named Gorshin, who was a printmaker, who did wonderful portraits of people on the street. Now, did I know where that was going to lead at the time? No, but I remember looking at those books, usually looking at them for the nude pictures or being a little astounded at some of those kinds of pictures. My father, as I said, was a doctor, and also there were medical texts, and we frequently looked at the drawings of things in the human anatomy, which never satisfied. But so, yes, I think the answer to the question of was I developing a picture sense was absolutely true. Whether I did that more than other children of my age, I don't know. My sister and my brother were both musicians. My sister was actually a prodigy, a pianist, who later went to Juilliard and was quite accomplished. And I had no music sensibility whatsoever. My father played the violin, and I think he really wanted the full quartet, but he never quite got it. I just didn't have any musical ear whatsoever, nor talent, and really felt growing up that I had very little talents and very little actual capabilities, other than I never doubted that I had intelligence. I think that's probably what saved me. I do remember the influence of my uncle, whom I mentioned earlier, who was a bachelor, lived with my grandmother, and got all the men's magazines of the period, which always were illustrated in a very pretty fantastic way, and also had racy pictures that by today's standard they're tame. And we spent some time in his room locked up looking at his stamp collection. At least that was the ruse. My father, as I said, had this Leica, and he took a lot of pictures, and we went on the family trips to the West, and he took all kinds of Kodachromes, a few of which are pretty fantastic, and which I have. And he didn't really have any talent, but he occasionally stumbled on a good picture. But he liked it a lot, and he gave me my first camera, which is a Brownie Hawkeye, which I still have. I sort of mimicked that with the little flash bulbs and made some snapshots and so on and so forth. It seemed to be the one thing that gave me some identity, was at least in my father's eye that I could mimic, because I couldn't mimic the music part. In many ways, I think my father, while not a terribly visual person, he wasn't unvisual, and he did do some photography. I mean, his great love was music and medicine, but he did love that Illinois prairie. He loved it, and he had grown up on it, and he had gone to school there. It was his life in many ways. So anyway, for whatever reason, I end up at the University of Illinois. I'm an English major, as I started to tell you. It seemed like the stupidest thing that a learning disabled, reading difficulty person could do. On the other hand, while I was no superstar, I did learn, and I read good things. I was always very select about what I read, because time was of the essence, so I never read crap at all, and I always, my courses led me to good things, and I got the overview of what culture was about and what literature was about. If I didn't get the specific, I certainly got the overview. And in retrospect, I certainly don't regret being an English major at all. In fact, I'm quite glad that I was. Skipping ahead, some difficult time at the University of Illinois. It was hard for me. I was lonely there, and it was a big, sprawling university. It was almost 30,000 people then. I'm a Kentucky person stuck in the middle of the Midwest with a lot of people who had nothing in common with. But anyway, as one does, you find your own way. End of my senior year in college. I had gotten married to a young girl, obviously, who was a journalism major, Susan Rose, and she was very, very energetic and smart and liberated and all kinds of things. And she and I were going to the Peace Corps. We got married to go in, to be together, so and so. We knew by then, I think, where we were going, I think, Ethiopia, but I'm not positive. At any rate, it was the last semester of my senior year. As happens at that point in your career in college, you usually have some electives that you're pretty free to take. And by that time my father had died. He had died in my sophomore year of college, very young, 54, and I got the proverbial Leica. Not really knowing how to use it, not really knowing anything about the dark room, even though I had spent some time in it as a child, I decided I was going to take a photo class. I was also a advertising journalism minor, and I could have taken it in the journalism department, where in fact my wife, we got married the last semester in my senior year as well, she was a journalism major, she took a course also. But something told me that that wasn't the place to do it, that that was too limited and in fact a little old-fashioned. Why I knew differently, I don't know. But for some crazy reason, I trundled over to the Cranart Art Museum, where I knew the art department was, and I started to investigate a photography course in the art department. I was told to go into the basement, and as I went into the basement of the building, photography was always in the basement, by the way, and has remained there pretty much up until the last number of years. Above the staircase was a big mural, a long, narrow mural of an Illinois landscape in black and white, with just little trees and houses and corn in the foreground dotted across that landscape. Later, I was to find that that was a fairly well-known picture by one Art Sinzabaugh. Art Sinzabaugh was an American photographer. That same picture hung in the permanent collection of the Museum of Modern Art for many years up until Sharkowski's death. That was, picture was always up. And he had done a series of important, I think, and undervalued American pictures called Midwest Chats, landscapes, panoramas. He used a 20 by 24 camera, but he cut the image down and just contacted it. This one had somehow had been blown up. When I looked at that picture, I can remember it like steel coming through your hit on the head with a steel bolt. I said, my God, that's the Illinois landscape. That's what my father was talking about all those years before. I went down to the basement. There was Art Sinzabaugh. He said, yeah, I'd love to have you in my photo course. I love English majors. I mean, I don't like art majors. So that was the beginning of my photo career. Last semester, senior year, I was taking a course with Art Sinzabaugh. Today we have covered in this little history, mostly an autobiographical story of my childhood, my involvement with pictures and photography through my father, who was an amateur, and the discovery of the Illinois landscape as being something beautiful, something that could be seen. By that I mean, I understood when I saw that Art Sinzabaugh picture that the camera, that there was a different way to see things, that if you looked, you could see things differently. And taking and discovering that course at the University of Illinois the last semester of my senior year was the beginning of my photographic career. Also the beginning of my discovery of my own talents and my own maturity and of my growth as a cultured, visual, and self-confident person. Mm-hmm.